bids us to focus on ways that Joseph Ratzinger, called to do great things, made witnessing to the gospel's call to live in humble service to all his priority. He offered that witness in three ways: through his dedication to scholarship, his unwavering conviction that belonging to a community defines our lives, and his radical dependence on the person of Jesus Christ. His scholarship. I have come to learn over the years that when people think about those who dedicate their lives to scholarship, a quality often overlooked is humility. It takes a good deal of humility to allow your mind to be formed not by your own musings and opinions, but by others as you interact and dialogue with them. It is a humility that rejects the myth of a self-made man. And it is noteworthy that as Benedict expressed gratitude in his last testament for those who contributed to his life, he purposely singled out those who journeyed with him as he learned. I warmly thank God for the teachers and pupils he has given me, he wrote. Taking up a life singularly dedicated to learning means giving yourself over to the voices of others in the past and in the present. It means ceding all claims of being an autonomous subject. Joseph Ratzinger, the great theologian, was that humble scribe instructed in the kingdom of heaven that we read about in the gospel, who, like the head of a household, brought from the storeroom both the new and the old. And so today, we should give thanks to all who enrich humanity through their scholarship, but also be more willing to likewise learn from others, humbly valuing the kind of lifelong learning that comes with dialoguing with people in the past and in the present. Community. From his earliest days, living in a loving family, Joseph Ratzinger learned the humility of living in a community. Learn that the authentic life is lived in community. Learn that we are connected to each other and that life is to be shared through sacrifice. I thank my parents, he wrote in his testament, who gave me life in a difficult time and who, at the cost of great sacrifices, with their love prepared for me a magnificent home that, like a clear light, illuminates all my days until today. My father's lucid faith taught us children to believe, and as a trail marker, it was always firm in the midst of all my scientific acquisitions. My mother's deep devotion and great kindness are a legacy for which I cannot thank enough, he wrote. Through this family experience, he acquired a humility that became second nature to him, leaving him with a palpable sense of being connected with others. It's no wonder that when he called the church to take up works of charity in his first encyclical, Deus Caritas Est, he reminded us that love needs to be organized. These words have their root in all that he learned at home, that for love to be authentic, it must connect us one to another, make demands on us, but also comfort us as we discover an interdependence that binds us together. It was this humility, acquired in being docile to learning within a community, that gave him the confidence to respond to the great call that he received. He learned at home that he was not alone, and thus he could do great things by being the servant of all. And finally, his deep relationship with Jesus. Perhaps one of the most often quoted lines of his writings is found in the first paragraph of Deus Caritas Est: being a Christian is not the result of an ethical choice or a lofty idea, but the encounter with an event, a person, which gives life a new horizon and a decisive direction. With his keen intellect, Joseph Ratzinger could have remained comfortable in the world of ideas and theories, but he made himself vulnerable to the point that his encounter with Jesus, rather than the safe world of ideas, gave decisive direction to his life. Pope Benedict provided a window into the overpowering experience of his relationship with the person of Jesus in his homily from the Mass of taking possession of the chair of Peter, which was celebrated on the solemnity of the Ascension in 2005. Christ's ascension, he said, is not a journey into space toward the most remote stars. Rather, by ascending to the Father, Christ led our human existence into God's presence, to the point that the human being now finds room in God. And so, by bringing us to the Father as he ascends, Christ is close to each of us forever. Each one of us can be on the intimate terms with him. Each can call upon him. The Lord is always within our hearing, he said. This profound sense of being ever close to the Lord marked his life to the very end. I was not surprised to read this week that his last words reportedly in his native German language was, "Jesus, ich liebe dich." Jesus, I love you. He humbled himself to enter into a trusting relationship to relate to Jesus not as a lofty idea or an ethical choice, but as a person who remained close to him. The funeral rites in the Christian tradition are designed to do two things: pray for the deceased and comfort those who mourn. The scriptures given to us on this feast of two great theologians and bishops, Basil and Gregory, help us to do both. They spur us to ask God to now bring to full stature in Christ a man who dedicated his entire life from an early age to building up the body of Christ. But these scripture passages also bring us comfort, prompting us to be grateful that we lived in a time when one who was called to be the greatest among us took seriously the gospel call to humble himself by being the servant of all, even if that meant resigning his office. May the promise of the gospel, that whoever humbles himself will be exalted, be fulfilled in him. And may he rest in peace, knowing of our gratitude and prayers for him this day. Stand with me now as we offer these prayers and intentions. In thanksgiving and praise, we offer them for Pope Emeritus Benedict, for the Church of God throughout the world, and for the world.
The Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI, who served the Church as Supreme Pontiff for 8 years, may worship God forever in the liturgy of heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Pope Francis and all who preach the gospel of Christ may be given strength in the word that they proclaim. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the peace of Christ may be established within all nations. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit may be strengthened by God's healing touch. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The that the dying who await the coming of the Lord may be freed from fear and filled with faith in the salvation God bestows. We pray to the Lord.
God of eternal life and truth, look with love on your church, and especially upon your departed servant, Benedict. Hear the prayers of your people, which we raise to you in faith. For we do this in the name of Christ, who is Lord, forever and ever.
Amen.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church.
We pray, O Lord, that through our prayers you may mercifully bestow a blessed reward on the soul of your servant Pope Benedict and us, your gifts of grace, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned for those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an earthly dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with the angels, archangels, thrones, dominions, with all the hosts, the powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Thank you.
and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, the glorious martyrs, all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Blaise our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant Joseph, Benedict, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours
forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we
forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us now extend to one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Renewed by the sacrament of our communion with you, our God, we pray, O Lord, that your servant, Pope Benedict, who served by your will on earth as a visible foundation of your church's unity, may be happily admitted to your blessed flock through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. With your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Our liturgy is now ending. May we go in peace, glorifying the Lord by our lives.